Hello, Malty. Mother mountains of mushy melting mangoes in Madagascar. We got there. I'm Ralfy. That was a malt mention, which is always the sign that a malt moment is about to happen. And here's the malt. We're going to have a moment. But first of all, a credit. Credit for the malt mention goes to Dan Carter. Thank you, Dan. Your malt mention has now been mentioned. I will now take it off the list. And Jameson Mokel will be next for the malt mention. But I tell you, what else is next? Is this a bottle of 25-year-old Glenfarclas single malt? I've been taking the opportunity recently to find some of the more affordable older whiskies out there, because after a few years experience with the younger stuff, to help you improve your calibre of experience and get points of reference, you need to buy some older whiskey. Now, it's entirely optional, but even if you're in a whiskey club, at least pull the money in together and get a bottle of older stuff. Now, generally, you'll find official bottlings, the price is really jumping. And one of the reasons that prices are jumping, apart from demand, is that distillers are making out that there is huge demand and therefore the prices are justified and people will accept it. That's certainly the case. And also, you have more people who are speculating that older whiskies will hold their value, and it's a safer place to leave their wealth than leaving it in a bank. So you've got all these permutations going on, and it's the politics of the human condition. It's always the companion of hard liquor, whether it be whiskey, rum, bourbon, rye, or whatever. So I poured a glass about half an hour ago, and it's just opening up now, a bit of oxidisation. 25-year-old Glenfarclas, bottled at 43%. In my opinion, it has been chill filtered. I think it's natural colour, but it doesn't state on the label. The label, of course, is the contract between the contents and the bottler and us. That is that label. That's where the information matters. And to Glenfarclas's credit, unlike some other distilleries, they don't change and chop their logos and branding and presentations all the time. And these procedures cost money, which ultimately the customer is charged. And to Glenfarclas's credit, over the generations, they've actually kept the signature of the distillery and the colour scheme pretty much the same. One reason for this is quite simple. Glenfarclas is still a family-owned company. It's one of the very, very few in Scotland. And another thing that I'd like to mention to you before nosing this old whiskey is that all the stills in the distillery are direct fired. Now, what I mean by that is that both the wash stills and the spirit stills, all pot stills, of course, being a single malt, they have rummagers inside them, which look like sort of chain-laced doormats. It's a good way of describing them. And they get turned around at the bottom of the pot, and they stop the contents, the wash, sticking to the bottom of the pot, because that's where the heat's coming from. You can either heat using coal, but generally they use gas flames now because it's more controllable. Distilleries that do it, Glenfiddich, Glenfarclas, of course, and of course, Springbank. If it's a small distillery just starting out, it's well worth having a direct fired still because it brings identity. Right, smell. Aromatic sherried ginger jam, slight cinnamon, sort of fruitcake. A classic integrated sherry matured whiskey. You get quite a few of them in Speyside. One of Glenfarclas's closest neighbours is Aberlour, and they also are synonymous, along with Glen Grant and Macallan, of being particularly successful as sherry matured malts. Now, as regards the source of sherry casks, That is a tall conversation for another video. It's something that I'll be discussing too before too long with Patreon pals as part of another series. But knowing about sherry casks is more complex than you realise. It's fairly simple actually, but it's not straightforward. I know, sounds all cryptic. Let's try a taste of this. ...43%, 25 years old and delicate. It's a low strength for the age. It's not delivering the punch. There's not enough alcohol there to push out the balance between spirit and cask that's really going on, and very successfully. It's a substantial malt, as one would expect, being direct fired stills. It's simply more toasted. I think that's probably the best way to describe it. More of a toasted grain note. Vanilla in there, brown sugar on the taste, a little nip of alcohol. Now I'm going to add some water. Where's my water? Here it is. I'm using a pint glass now for holding my water for the simple reason it's always good when you're having a whiskey to have water to drink. I have in this teaspoon, this 5 milliliters teaspoon, just get rid of the drip there, about 2 milliliters of water. Not a lot. Quarter of a teaspoon. That's all this'll need. It's already been pre-dilute down to 43. Thank goodness Glenfarclas didn't put it down to 40%, because that would have been a disaster. But to their credit, for a 25-year-old whiskey, it's much more affordable than others. And don't let the price put you off that it must be an inferior malt or simply not as good as others, which are more expensive. That, malt mates, is simply not the case on a regular basis. Some of the most expensive whiskies out there, I would not entertain at all. And I don't care about how old they are and the provenance and how they were found in some dusty warehouse in the back of Beyond and Timbuktu and the, you know, these stories that you get. There comes a point actually that I get a bit cynical about the orthodox messaging coming out of distilleries, and I'd rather just ignore it and just connect directly with the contents of the bottle and leave it at that. It just seems more practical. Now, I'm not suggesting for one minute that they're telling lies or anything. What I'm suggesting is they're simply being economical with the truth. That's a very British saying, that economical with the truth. And it's business. I've added a drop of water. Will this amplify slightly and improve a little? Yes, it will. Very aromatic. It's got an eau de vie note, or rather an eau de cask note. It's almost confectionery. The flavour of the oak cask. Very ripe melon, ripe, super ripe medjool figs. There's certainly a little, but not a little, there's a prominent note of sherry going on, coming from the casks. It's quite distinctive. It's got that post-Paxeret note to it, that Oloroso thing, that sherry syrup style. It's a really shame that it's been chill filtered, particularly that age. But then again, it's reflected in the price, apart from, of course, if you happen to be in a country where you get absolutely zonked for taxes and import duties and such. Let's come back to this. I haven't, incidentally, I've reviewed the 108, which is the cask strength non-age statement, Glenfarclas. All this happened between 2014, 2018. So there's about 5 Glenfarclas reviews in the archives. All you have to do is go to my search box in my channel and just put in Glenfarclas and you'll get all the reviews. There's one of the 12, one of the 21, and 2 of the 15-year-old, which in my opinion, for bang for your buck for Glenfarclas, the 15-year-old at 46% is the best of the lot. But all credit to an older whisky at a more affordable price if you're in the UK. It's the reason I've bought it, the reason I'm reviewing it. Very pleasant too, and it's worth looking out for the fact that Glenfarclas have a range called the Family Casks. Because when you have a family-owned, privately-owned distillery, they're not investing in anything else but the future, and therefore they look after older and older stock. So you will not find another distillery in the whole of Britain which has such a timeline of single malt Scotch whisky made at that distillery. Nobody surpasses Glenfarclas. And that's what makes it actually quite collectible, along with the fact that collectors aren't that interested in it. You know, the speculative collectors, but the genuine enthusiast collectors, they are interested in it. And again, this gives additional interest to Glenfarclas. If you're gonna start with it, start with the 12-year-old. That's my recommendation. It's a good, substantial, beefy malt at a pretty accessible price. There's a 30-year-old and the 40-year-old out there, by the way, but those, the prices have absolutely rocketed recently, so I'm not buying them. This is about as far as I'll go with a Glenfarclas review in terms of an age statement. Some really good quality wood is exerting itself now in the nose. It's quite aromatic. Whereas just a few minutes ago when I nosed and tasted this, it was cask influence, but it wasn't that expressive. Now it is. Very nice casks. These casks, of course, this 2000, so this would be bottled in the, the casks would be filled about 1995, 94, even maybe up down to 1990. So you're looking at a different generation of wooden casks. And I really don't think they go in much for barrel hopping at Glenfarclas, where they move one malt to another to beef it up and modify it and give it ever so many finishes. You don't really see that happening in Glenfarclas, which is nice. One more smell and taste. The wood is quite assertive now, but what's redeeming is the quality of the wood. It's pretty good. Very good, actually. With the sherry sort of relegated to the background on the nose, which is unusual with whiskies. Big fruit fruit cake arrival. Sweet and sour. Lots of sour. Some nice tanniny, savoury notes. Dry spices. Ginger, nutmeg, raisin, overripe melon. And a hint of molasses and licorice in the background. Very pleasant, very nice. In fact, when you add a drop of water, it's almost as if the taste of volume gets turned up in this dram. And that's not unusual with old whiskies. The finish. Ginger, cinnamon, cola cubes, Coca-Cola nut confectionery. So there's not Coca-Cola, but cola nuts, different flavour. And absolutely delicious, malt mark. I'm going to give this 89 out of 100. It's a malt mark. If it had been bottled at 46% unchill filtered, it'd have been a 91. And there you have it, malt mates. I'm Ralfy in the Bothy, done and dusted with another review. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you pop back again, I'm going to be discussing rum. I'm just going to be sitting here. In fact, I'll maybe go and get a glass of rum for my extras, 836 extras, because there's a special day coming up soon on the calendar, on the annual drinks calendar, and I want to tell you about it and why I think it's quite important. I'm Ralfy. Where's my big clivey.com clicker? Here it is. I press the red button, and then as soon as I've done that, this video is over. Thank you for watching. Subscribe, click like, etc., etc., etc. and enjoy your malts responsibly. Bye-bye.